Welcome to the Shared Practices Podcast. This is the intro to a three-part series. George, explain to us what we're trying to do here.
So we're going to talk about fee-for-service acquisitions for the next 3 weeks. And the reason why I wanted to do, or Richard actually, this is Richard's idea, why we wanted to do fee-for-service practice acquisitions as our transition case study is because I think they're more delicate in how they're transitioned. And I think the lessons on good practices in a general transition are more evident and obvious watching people transition fee-for-service practices, because there's not as much incentive for patients to stay since they probably stayed with the previous doctor and they didn't take their insurance. Now, when a new doctor comes in, they're more likely to leave. And so I think this is a great three-part series talking about transitions in general through the lens of a fee-for-service practice acquisition.
Yeah, and I think just there's this sentiment that more can go wrong in a fee-for-service transition, and it's not necessarily people's fault. You know, it's something that can't always be predicted. You can be as aware as possible. And I like the combination of interviews that we have that show both kind of positive transitions and maybe some struggles, and then also, you know, just different ways of doing it and overall advice. So to introduce Drew real quick, Drew and I met each other at the Voices of Dentistry conference, which is coming up now. I don't know, by the time this episode airs, it'll be pretty close. Last year. So it's been just a year, and we went out on the town in Nashville and had chicken together, and he was like, man, I should do a podcast. And we were spitballing different ideas for podcasts, and I was telling him what equipment to buy. So it's awesome to hear that Drew Brynes, that he now has his own fee for service podcast. So it's just super exciting to me, and I'm excited to talk to him about this interview if he's there this year.
Yeah, he is going to be there. I think I had spoken to him during the interview. And cool. His practice, just quickly before we dive into the interview, he bought a fee-for-service practice in Orlando, and, okay, you know, more big city, you know, maybe a saturated part of Orlando, so he says. And so I think it's a good start, so kind of keep that in mind as you start listening, because we get to it later in the interview, but it's nice to have it at the beginning.
Awesome. Okay, here we go with Dr. Drew Brynes.
I'm excited for the next three episodes. We're going to be starting almost a three-part series talking about buying fee-for-service practices and also principles that apply to other acquisitions. I think fee-for-service practices are just a good thing to look at because a lot of the principles apply. And so I have with me today Drew Brynes. And Drew, he bought a fee-for-service practice and he currently is out of network with all the insurances, but he also has a fee-for-service dentistry podcast. And so I thought it'd be a good opportunity to have him on the show. And we'll kind of kick off this three-part series. And so I wanted to introduce you all to Drew, and I'll give him a minute to introduce himself. How's it going, Drew?
G-Money, it's good to be here. Is it okay? Can I call you G-Money, or do you prefer just Money?
You know, Justin Short is probably really proud of all the nicknames that he left behind from our mini-series. So yeah, G-Money, G-Unit, all of the G ones. Yeah, definitely. Any of them are good.
Yeah, we have Justin to thank for that. I enjoyed the mini series, and thank you for having me here.
No problem. So one thing before we get started, I think it's really cool that you listen to our podcast. I always try to get people who listen to our podcast actually on the show whenever they can. So I think that's cool. And, you know, why don't you just start by introducing yourself to our audience and, you know, a little about yourself?
Sure. I'd love to. So I graduated from dental school in 2013, and I then practiced for about a year. When I was kind of determined that I wanted to have my own practice one day. No, I was determined that I wanted to be in private practice. And I was pretty determined to stay out of the corporate world if I could, right? So for that first year out of school, I kind of did everything that I could to work in private practice. And I found that that was challenging, as some of your listeners might be able to relate to. I certainly interviewed with corporations because you got to keep all of your options open. But what I did for that first year was, I mean, I was relentless in searching for private practice jobs, because what I found was not every private practice dentist is ready to take on an associate. You know, they might be able to take you on one day a week or 2 days a week. So there was a period of time in that first year where I had, I think, maybe four different jobs just kind of running around town. You know what? I think I got off track. You wanted me to introduce myself, so and I started talking about that first year out of school. But that's relevant because I was only a year out of school, when I bought my practice, which I'm sure we'll get into. But yeah, I grew up and I live in Central Florida, went to the University of Florida for college and for dental school. And today I am the owner of my own fee-for-service practice in Winter Park, Florida. And we're out of network with all insurance companies. And I took it over from a dentist who had retired after practicing for about 40 years. And a dentist before him opened it in 1939. So there's kind of been a lot of interesting things to go along with that I'm sure we can get into, like how to transition from the old patients to kind of warm them up so we don't lose many in the transition because they were used to everything being a certain way for so long. So that's maybe a mini introduction to me and my story there.
So you're a 1939 startup? You bought a 1939 startup? That's
I did. And I promise you, when I started going through all of the drawers and all the equipment, I think some of the original supplies are still in the office today.
You got some antiques in there, don't you? That's pretty funny.
We do.
Oh, that's hilarious. So Winter Park, Florida, can we start by kind of describing? I have no idea what that town is like. So what's the size of that population and where is that in relative to the rest of Florida?
Okay, so I don't have the exact population size, but I can describe it pretty well for you. So we are we're right next door to Orlando, downtown Orlando. Not right next to Disney, you know, or maybe about 40.
So you're a suburb of Orlando?
We are.
Okay,
yes.
Perfect.
So we're a small town within a bigger city, and it's a pretty saturated market as far as dentists are concerned. There's a lot of people, but there's a lot of dentists. And the demographics within my town are a mix, right? There's a lot of really wealthy people and there's a lot of not really wealthy people. And we're kind of, you know, while I said we're out of network, our demographic of our patients is kind of middle of the road. We certainly have some wealthy people and we have plenty of not wealthy people. So it's a fair mix, but there are a lot of corporations around me, a lot of chain dental offices, a lot of private practices. All in all, though, I'd say there's a great group of dentists, private practice dentists, that we have study clubs and we get lunch together, and it's a you know, saturated market, but a good place to be.
And so, Drew, let's go back to your associateship experience. So, your the time that you did spend in all of those practices before you bought your specific practice, did you spend any of them in a fee-for-service practice, or were they all in network with insurance?
I did. So, you know, I grew up going to the same dentist my whole life, and he was part of when I went off to dental school. You know, I kind of had a job offer on the table from him, and he was a fee-for-service dentist. He practiced with his dad, and his dad was going to be retiring, and it seemed like this is what I'm going to do. It's going to be great. I'm going to be mentored by this guy, and I'll eventually buy into the practice as his dad retires. And I thought I had my path figured out, but and that was the first job I took, but he was only busy enough to really take me on 2 days a week. And, you know, I think part of the growth plan was just me being there. And while that may have worked at one point in time, it wasn't working today. So I went from 2 full days a week to 2 half days a week to eventually, you know, not working there at all anymore. Just because there wasn't the demand. His dad had kind of slowly already retired. He officially retired pretty much right when I started, but he was down to 2 days, maybe 1 day a week by that point. So it wasn't like I was walking into a full practice with patients there for me. And some of the dentists listening might be able to relate when there's a transition like that, you know, the patients want to be able to see, they don't want to really see the new guy always. So that can make things difficult as well.
That makes sense. And so was that the reason why you decided to go into a fee-for-service practice? Is that your experience with your childhood dentist being fee-for-service made you want the same thing?
So what my perception of his office was definitely what I wanted. You know, he had a great family office where he really cared for his patients and seemed like the feeling was mutual that, you know, you saw he had families, generations of families going through there and you got to see people grow up and just everyone really cared about each other. And that's what I wanted. You know, that didn't have to be fee-for-service or PPO or whatever. So that's what I was trying to recreate. Now, knowing that he was out of network with all insurances did certainly kind of influence the way I perceived all offices. But I think the important part is to figure out what your vision is for your office and try to create that. It just so happened for me. Okay, let me back up a step because you asked me if any of the offices that I worked in were fee-for-service. So in that year or so, I did work in his, and that was fee for service. But then I also worked in one that was pretty heavily PPO. I worked in a few that were pretty heavily PPO. I don't know that I worked in any others that were strictly fee for service. I definitely did for a few months there. I don't know that I can give a fair comparison between all of them in my experience. I was trying to learn as much as I could about the business side in all the offices that I was in. I wasn't the one true fee-for-service practice that I was in the longest. I learned a lot about their customer service and how they treat their patients, but they weren't able to keep me busy enough. So that's why I had to move on. To come full circle here, you know, I think a good tip that I might have for your listeners would be, you know, always keep your eyes open on what's out there. So I got wind of this practice that was fee-for-service that was for sale, and it was exactly where I wanted to be. You know, my wife and I have loved Winter Park for a long time. We wanted to live here. It was like right next door to the suburb that I grew up in. It's a beautiful part of town. So this practice, when I heard it was for sale, I had to take a look at it, and it happened to be fee-for-service, and that was attractive to me, if I'm being honest. Simply because I wasn't certain that I understood the ins and outs of insurance, and fee-for-service sounded simpler to me. You know, I was only a year out of school, never intending to own my own practice, certainly not that early. Figured I would buy in somewhere. So it was a big leap for me to try and purchase this practice and try and run it. So with so little experience in running a practice, if that makes sense.
That makes sense. So you almost backed into the fee-for-service in a way because you had a hard time finding a great opportunity in private practice as an associate. So you found this fee-for-service practice for sale in the part of town you wanted to live in, so you just jumped on it?
That's pretty much what happened, you know. And I will say that this was maybe the second or kind of the third practice I looked at. And I wasn't really intending to – when I went to look at them, I wasn't thinking it would be the right time for me to buy them. A practice, but I figured, hey, it doesn't hurt to get my feet wet and see what's out there. And honestly, the further along I went in the process of exploring the acquisition of this practice, I kind of just expected almost for things to not work out for some reason. But it was kind of like we would negotiate a little bit more and, you know, get a little bit further along the process. And I was kind of surprised that we were still moving in this direction. I figured it would fall through at some point. It didn't. So I kept pushing, and here we are.
It's funny. I was going to ask you about the practice, but I had that same type of sensation when I was going through my process. I was like, you know, I feel like at some point I'm going to find a red flag that's going to make me want to walk away, but I just didn't find it. So I felt fortunate. But back to the practice you're looking at, what was the, I was curious to see, you know, the profile. So what, you know, how big was it? How many ops? What collection size? How many staff were there? What was all that?
So we can get into that. So it had 5 ops, and the previous 3 years of collections before I took it over were just under $600,000 each year.
Okay.
And, you know, what sold me on it was a couple of factors beyond just the location and the style. The dentist, I felt he described it to me as just he does pretty much bread and butter dentistry. You know, he did some limited endo, some limited wisdom tooth extractions. And I did, you know, not as much as he did, but at that point I was comfortable doing a little bit of both of those. But other than that, I mean, it was pretty much just restorative. And I certainly didn't look at the numbers as intensely as you've talked about in your show. I didn't know how to at that point. But I think a lot of it for me, honestly, was luck. Him and I hit it off because I try to be as conservative as possible in my treatment recommendations. I'm rather comfortable doing larger composite restorations, and he was certainly of that same philosophy. So I'll put it this way, though. There was, within the practice, there was a lot of dentistry to be done, a lot of older amalgams, teeth that were breaking. Those are things you can't really tell by numbers. Actually, I think that you can tell by numbers.
Yeah, I was going to say, but yeah, for the most part, people don't know that going in. You're right about that. Most people don't know what's going on going into the practice.
Right. So 5 ops, $600,000 in collections. He had, I believe it was 5 employees. It was 2 hygienists, 1 assistant, and 2 people up front. And here was something else interesting that I didn't really appreciate at the time. He took a lot of vacation, right? So he took off He was taking off maybe 1 week every other month. I think it was every 5 weeks or so he was taking a week off.
Wow.
So rather than you know, just retiring, he kind of slowly retired and condensed his schedule down into the remaining days. So, and I was a little bit slower starting off. So in my, you know, in practicing dentistry and treatment. So just by me being there and now being open those weeks, one thing that we did was I think he had two hygienists working 4 days a week. So now that we've opened up all those weeks that we weren't previously, the hygiene schedule kind of thinned out. So I kind of cut back on the hygiene days a little bit. I had one hygienist work 3 days a week, and I think one went down to 3.5 or maybe 3 for a while. But then it opened up my chair time. So it was like comparatively, as we watched the numbers grow from year to year, we've kind of grown by 20 to 24% each year. And initially, at least, I think a lot of that was due to just to me having more chair time available over the course of the year, if that makes sense.
That's awesome. So I guess that kind of led me to my next types of questions. But so you guys, so an increase in capacity then led to some growth. And so you guys have had that kind of consistent 20 to 25% each year since, how many years ago was that now? Like three?
Yeah, we're about three and a half years.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. So what was it? So before we go on, one thing that I like to talk about buying a fee-for-service practice, and we're going to do it in the next three episodes for everyone listening. So when you buy a fee-for-service practice, one thing I think it's important to understand is why that seller was able to be fee-for-service and thrive in a fee-for-service environment. So in your mind, looking at the practice before you purchase it, what in your mind allowed your seller to survive as a fee-for-service practice, especially in a, you know, saturated market with, you know, a lot of other options for patients that may have insurance?
Right. Great question. So I don't know how helpful this is going to be, but to be honest with you, this is my assessment. Okay, so dental insurance in general kind of started around the 70s or so, from what I've learned, and was a great deal for patients and dentists initially, and it's kind of become a worse and worse deal for dentists every year, every decade, as, you know, they don't really cover much more now than they did in the 70s. In fact, they probably are covering less. So to put that in context of your question, I think a lot of his patients had just been in the practice for a long time, either when before dental insurance really came about and they're still paying cash, or, you know, it was just the relationships that he had built of being in a practice for so long before patients were so insurance minded. So, you know, and to make a quick plug here, so my goal and my challenge, right, has been, how do I stay fee for service? Because that's my goal, really. I'm kind of really determined to stay out of network with dental insurance companies for the remainder of my career. And, you know, he was able to do it because he started really before insurance was kind of a big thing. But now it is the thing. And there's so much of the, you know, our target demographic has dental insurance and they want to use it, and that makes sense. So it's a challenge. It's a real challenge. So my goal is to just continually raise the bar in customer service and patient care, and always quality of care first, right? So that our patients, you know, would be willing to go out of network.
I mentioned in a previous episode that one of our biggest issues right now as young dentists and dental students is our student loan debt. It is one of the main reasons why we strive at Shared Practices to navigate the path to successful practice ownership. We aim to help our audience by doing everything we can to help you earn a great income as a dentist. It has always been my advice to tackle your student loan debt by refinancing your loans after becoming a practice owner with a stable income. Doing this allows you to avoid paying too much on your monthly interest. The key to refinancing your loans is selecting an experienced lender that will offer you a competitive interest rate. Did you know that most student loans charge the same rate regardless of how creditworthy you are? So chances are, as dentists, you're probably paying too much in monthly interest. Laurel Road, a division of Darien Roatan Bank, is a national leader in student lending. Laurel Road has helped medical professionals across the country refinance their federal and private dental school debt, saving thousands on interest over the life of their loans. Not only do they offer great terms and great service, ADA members receive an additional 0.25% rate discount on top of their new and already low rate for as long as they remain an ADA member. Fill out a 2-minute application and get pre-approved rates instantly if you are eligible. It's free to apply and there's no obligation to accept. For more information specific to your needs as a dentist and to submit an application, simply visit www.laurelroad.com/sharedpractices. Again, that is laurelroad.com/sharedpractices. Laurel Road is an equal housing and opportunity lender. All rates are subject to eligibility. Savings may vary. This is a paid promotion of student loan refinancing by Laurel Road.
Did I answer your question? I think I got off topic there.
I think you did a really nice job answering that question because, you know, I think that's important to understand when you go into a practice. And so you knew like, okay, well, this is a relationship-based practice where, you know, he met these people before they had that, you know, he met them when nobody had insurance pretty much and then was able to keep them in spite of the, you know, emergence of PPOs because of the fact that he had good relationships with them and they trusted him and it was the doctor-patient relationship and whatnot. So going into it, I think you understand that your challenge transitioning that type of practice was maintaining that same type of goodwill with the patient base when you may not inherently have it like he did. So I think that's a challenge. And so what kind of things going into your transition now? So now we've, you know, essentially purchased the practice. What kind of things did you do to maybe help keep those patients there? Or, you know, how did that go? So I'm assuming they stayed since you've grown, but I could be wrong.
No. For the most part, you're going to have some attrition. But for the most part, I've been very satisfied with the amount of retention that we've had. You know, because we had people that were maybe driving an hour because they started with this dentist and then they moved away, but they kept coming back for that relationship, right? And so I expected to lose those types of patients. You know, there's a certain amount of that, or maybe the spouse came here for that certain dentist, but you know, the other spouse, maybe the husband came here, but his wife went somewhere else and somewhere closer to their home. And when he retired, maybe the husband decided to go to the wife's dentist. You'll get a fair amount of that, or a small amount of that, I'll say. That's what we had, a small amount. And that not much you can do about that, but just be friendly and welcome them back if they ever so choose. But for the most part, we had great retention. And so what did I do to make that transition better? Because what we've just said is that the reason he was able to stay fee for service is because he was who he was, and they valued that. And I was not him. I looked very different than he did, just, you know, much younger. And I got all those jokes about, I've got fillings that are older than you. And it's hard when someone makes a joke like that because they're usually right. Yeah. So, okay. So what did I do? I did my best to become him. not exactly, but I tried to not change anything in the practice, at least for the first year. You know, for everything from the decor to the way that he was, I tried to kind of mimic the way that he would talk to people a little bit. You know, I wanted to be authentically who I am, but I tried to focus on how we were similar in our treatment planning philosophies. You know, I'd say, you know, like you know and appreciated from the previous dentist, he was very conservative. I try to plan in that same fashion. You know, that's why we got along so well. Things like that. You know, always bring it back to the old guy that they liked and trust. And obviously, we sent out a letter to all the patients announcing the transition and that he trusted me. Now here's a bit that I think would pique your interest, because when we were negotiating on the contract or on the purchase price, you know, and I don't mind sharing. So the price, I think he initially asked for $375,000 for the practice, which, you know, is market, depends on your market if that's a good or bad price, but around here that was a fair price.
Yeah, it seems great. Yeah,
right. Yeah, I know you could charge a lot more in some markets, so keep in mind that it was an older practice, right? So I mean, there was film x-rays, paper charts. I think there were 3 computers in the whole place. It needed a lot of updating. So with that in mind, you know, I submitted a lower offer. And, you know, my goal was to offer, I think I offered 300 and he wanted 325. And so what we ended up doing was we settled on 300 up front. And then after the first year, it was agreed that I would owe him another $25,000 depending on how the practice did. So if I hit the same number of collections that he hit, I owed him that $25,000. And then we had like a tier where if I was maybe 90% of the collections, then I owed him $20,000. I forget the exact tier, but we went down all the way to zero. I wouldn't owe him anything if it was too low. And that might sound funny and strange why we structured it that way. That was my dad's idea. And at that point, none of us knew if I'd be able to run a practice well and fill his shoes, basically. What it did for me mentally was it kind of ensured his goodwill. Now, I think that I would have had his goodwill no matter what. He was a great guy, and that helped out a lot. You know, he didn't turn around and stab me in the back and violate our non-compete or anything like that. And open up another practice across the street. He was ready to retire. He had been ready to retire for a long time. So, but what it did for me was it ensured me that he was going to want me to succeed and want to represent me well to the patients that he knew in the community. You know, there was always a risk that after we closed the deal, he might say something to one of his former patients about, you know, something negative about me that could spread through town or something. And like I said, he wouldn't have done that. But this gave me a little bit of extra assurance that was unique. I haven't really heard of that type of structure in a practice acquisition before, but that worked out well for us. So that was one extra little tidbit in what I did to help, I guess, make that transition smooth. I guess the point there is just the goodwill from the dentist that he wants you to succeed is really helpful, and that he's going to speak well to the existing patient base about you.
I think that's huge. And you know, I think we just actually released the whole episode on that with Brian Pender about how he said in that episode, one of the things you really want when you sell your practice is for the seller to, for the rest of their life, every time they think of you, they smile. And, you know, I think that's a goal. I'm going to make a comment, though, about that. I think that's such a neat arrangement. My initial thoughts on that is it's such a small percentage of the deal. I mean, it's like less than 10% of the deal is this, mm-hmm. you know, leeway. If you're going to do it, then, you know, I think it would have been hilarious if you had done like a larger percentage of that. But either way, I think that's really cool that you structured it that way. It's almost like you bought charts where you're paying, you know, mm-hmm. based on if you're able to replicate. That's pretty cool. That's awesome.
Yeah. And then what I ended up doing was I took out a loan for $325,000 and basically used that $25,000 as an initial working capital, which a lot of people would like more cushion than that. So it may have been a little bit risky on me. I really am debt averse. So, but it worked out great. And we, you know, exceeded collections that first year. And so he got his full amount and everyone was happy.
Yeah, I think that's great. And, you know, one of the things you mentioned I want to go back on is the things that you can compare yourself to with your seller. Another thing that I think is important is so much about it is the seller and what they're like, because that's what the mm-hmm. patients are used to. And, you know, in my case, when I was talking to my sellers, you know, the two things that they kept talking about is, you know, we're really efficient and people appreciate that we're like, we get them in and out quickly. And I mean, I'm buying a PPO, like very insurance involved practice. And then mm-hmm. they're very casual and informal with their patients. And those are two qualities that I think would describe my wife and I. And so I felt that a lot of things about our transition would be smooth just because we're similar in our styles. And so, I feel like you kind of you touched on that same point. I think it's important. I want to make point of that in the process to make sure that, you know, you are not going from like hot to cold or, you know, somebody who's very low energy to somebody who's very high energy and like comprehensive care right. and like all these things that patients are not used to. Mm-hmm. I think that can really ease the transition. Another thing I want to talk to you about was staff. I'm assuming that mm-hmm. when you said that nothing changed for a year, that includes the current staff. Or the staff that was there, what was that like? You know, who was there, what roles, and, you know, is everyone still there? How did that work?
So I'll answer that last question first. We only have one person left from the original staff.
Okay.
And that is my assistant. So how that worked, one of the selling points for me was, I mean, he told me it was a well-oiled machine, is how he described his practice, that everyone knew their role and they did it well. There was no drama. And that I wouldn't really have to do much practice management, that it's going to, everyone just knows their roles. And assuming that was true, which for the most part it was, that's great until somebody quits or if I have to let somebody go and now I have to train the new person. So I certainly, there was a lot of practice management involved. But up front, I knew that our financial coordinator was going to be retiring about a month after the dentist did. And that was kind of a huge hit, a huge blow, because patients really liked her. And she was kind of the brains up front. She managed pretty much everything up front. So it was, when she did retire, it was somewhat of a blessing and somewhat of a curse. I would love to have kept her on much, much longer. But it was kind of, as everyone has retired one by one, we've been able to update things easier. She was all paper for everything. And she had her system that she knew well, but you know, we really weren't utilizing the computers in the way that they should be utilized. So, okay, so transitioning, we had, I think most people would tell you, when you buy a practice like that, you want to try to retain the hygienists for as long as you can, if the patients have developed a good relationship with them. One of the hygienists was there for 33 years, so patients loved her. So patients will go to see the hygienist often, you know, they'll have a stronger attachment to the hygienist above the dentist. So I wanted to retain her at all costs. And she retired about a year ago now. But before then, you know, we had our other hygienist who was not on the same page as I was with the direction in which I was taking the practice. And just with the standard of care, with perio treatment and, you know, just basics, just charting. And it was, you know, they're both from a different era, let's say. So we kind of had a sit down at one point and she didn't show up to work the next day. You know, she just decided to quit. And that was another thing that was a blessing and a curse, because every time somebody has quit or retired, we've been able to find a really great person to replace them. So right now I feel like I've got a team of all stars. I would have kept everyone on longer if I could have. But the way the transitions happened with who we got in there to fill their shoes, I think it's all been for the best.
And so if you don't mind me asking, so everyone that left and you replaced them, has that person that you replaced them with stayed until you, or has there been turnover in other positions?
Yeah, good question. And this is something that I kind of had a lot of anxiety about. Okay, so we haven't had any hygienists leave after they've been hired, right? So our original two are gone. But then we've hired two and a half right now. We're juggling days. We have three total that work kind of, you know, between a job for two, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I got it.
And okay, you got it. So but up front, we have had in the one chair, the financial coordinator position, since the original person retired, we have had two people there. The first person who I hired to do that role was doing it for the first time. I didn't know how to do it. She didn't know how to do it. That was a bad idea.
Gotcha.
Because after she quit, after about a year, we got someone in that position who did know how to do the job. And in the first month, she brought in an additional $10,000 of just outstanding claims that weren't filed, or I'm not even sure to this day where the money came from, but the person who was there was not doing it well. So there was that. Now, the other person up front, the patient coordinator, since that person left, her, the one that originally came with the practice, since she left, we were great to find somebody off the bat who patients loved. And she was with us for about a year and a half, and then she decided she wanted to be at home full time with her kids. And then we had somebody for about a month who just quit. Took another position, a higher paying job, couldn't compete with it. So we now are just transitioning with somebody new. So my point, though, was that I certainly had kind of a lot of stress. You know, my goal all along was to not spook patients. You know, they have been seeing the same faces for so long. And the last thing that I want to do is have a rotating chair of new faces for them to meet. A lot of our patient base was older. They don't like change. So I was holding off on things like updating the decor, even though it kind of desperately needed it, I just wanted them to feel like everything's the same and that they can trust us and all of that. But my hand was forced a few times as people wanted to retire or quit or what have you. So that's kind of where we ended up and how we got there. But and now I feel like we're moving from the phase of wanting to keep things the same to now I've done as much as I can to win people over. And now I'm really moving in the direction of kind of creating that practice that I've envisioned. So it's kind of an exciting time now.
I'm really happy you talked about your ideal practice because that's I think that's important too. You know, you transition, you transfer ownership, patients get to know you. And then at that point, you really got to make it yours. And it's exciting that you're doing that now. But before we get into that part of it, I was curious to see, so you had some staff turnover, not the fault of your own, just, you know, older staff wanting to make a change. So what usually that would hurt, you know, page, like you just mentioned, you don't want to spook people. So what did you do, do you think, to maybe mitigate that? Or it seems like you did a great job transitioning the practice. So what kind of things do you think you did well to keep patients coming?
You know, I think that clear communication is key, right? So when our hygienist who had been there for 33 years finally said that she was going to retire, you know, I was hoping that she would give me a few more years, but when she finally said no, you know, she gave me some decent notice. I forget how long. When she finally said that she's going to retire, we planned a retirement party for her, and it was to honor her for all the you know, years that she had been caring for our patients, but it was also almost just as much as a PR move, almost just to let the patients know, like, this is a happy transition. I'm not firing her. come to this retirement party. Let's celebrate. And, you know, while it was kind of like we only worked together maybe for a year and a half, 2 years at the most, and while I could have been bitter about paying for this, it was not cheap to have the retirement party. It's like, shouldn't the old dentist be paying for this? You know, it was my idea, and I wanted it for that transition, right? So we had a lot of patients show up, and even more than just patients showing up was us being able to invite patients, handing out invitations, emailing out invitations, Paula's retiring, making a big deal of it on the front end so that when she is gone, we get as little surprise negative reaction as possible. That was kind of our most difficult transition, was those following 6 months once she was gone, because not everybody did know. We did our best. We put the word out on Facebook, but as you can imagine, with an older patient base, emails and Facebook isn't always going to get the word out to them. So we had a small handful of people. I mean, I can think of maybe two people, maybe three, that like showed up for their appointment, found out Paula wasn't here, and then left. And
wow.
That was like worst case scenario, but we were kind of expecting that. You know, that's what we were trying to avoid all along. So the fact that it was only three was a win for me, because if we hadn't handled that well, worst case scenario for me would have been if she had just quit, right? Worst case would have been if she quit and took a job next door or down the street or something and people followed her. But with a retirement like that, that's a, you know, people understand that, people get that. I was hoping that I would have had a couple more years to transition the goodwill from her over to our newer hygienist, but that's okay. And we got to get some good photographs taken. And now those photographs at the retirement party with her and our new hygienist are kind of playing in a loop in a slideshow in our office. And people still see her and still, you know, hopefully there's some goodwill being transferred there. So I've done a lot to try to make people feel comfortable and to make them feel like we're not trying to change everything on them. But like I said, now is kind of the time for change. Now we're moving into that new phase where either they're going to like us or not. You know, they've been here with us for a few years now, so now we need to stop worrying about scaring the old patients and how are we going to attract the new patients.
Our mission at Shared Practices is to navigate the path to successful practice ownership. As this is something that we are constantly trying to improve, we ask for feedback from people who have already become practice owners. Feedback that we've been getting is that our podcast does not allow listeners to get enough information in an organized way where they can actually apply it to their situation as they're looking to buy a practice. I think this is the biggest area where our podcast falls short. We try our best to infuse the podcast with information, but ultimately the medium at which it is consumed does not always allow us to get exactly what we want for it. This is why we've created the Ownership Accelerator. We saw a need for an in-depth and comprehensive course to cover both practice acquisitions and journey into practice ownership. It is our way of fixing all the things that we wish we could accomplish with our podcast, but are not able to. That being said, we have finally released the Ownership Accelerator. The Ownership Accelerator is an online course that takes you step by step through the entire process of buying a dental practice. The idea behind the course was based on our experiences helping people find practices, analyze deals, and ultimately their experiences closing. We saw the things that made some buyers successful and other ones not as successful. We saw challenges they face and ways to stack their cards in their favor to find a great practice. We teamed up with Paul Goodman, who has tons of experience working with both buyers and sellers. We also enlisted the help of professionals David Alvey, Brian Pender, and Rob Montgomery. The result was a comprehensive online course about buying a dental practice that consists of 12 sections, more than 80 10 to 12 minute videos, and the entire course comes out to be about 15 hours long. Included in the course is a 250-page course manual that gets shipped to you to help you go through the course. Also included, we have spreadsheets, worksheets, and checklists to keep you on track as you go through the process of buying a dental practice. The ultimate goal of the course is to help you find the right practice to buy, not just any practice, but the right practice for you. We strongly believe that the right practice will maximize your income and career satisfaction. Ask yourself what your career would look like if you bought a practice that maximized your income and career satisfaction. Visit ownership.sharedpractices.com for more information. I'll leave a link in the show notes. Start your career off on the right foot and take the Ownership Accelerator today. Okay, so let's kind of transition that into that topic. By the way, I love the retirement party idea because, like you said, nobody can get upset at you for, you know, retiring or like, you know, you have to replace her or else they have no one to clean their teeth. So, you know, I think that's a
right.
That's a great idea. Did you not do a retirement party for your seller?
You know, that probably would have been a good idea. Nope, we didn't. We sent a letter out and we transitioned over the course of a month where he was introducing me to patients. I would have liked to have that time have been longer, but his philosophy was there just wasn't enough patients for both of us to be there for 6 months practicing dentistry. And he was right. I think the month was perfect because, you know, it gets a little bit awkward if there were two dentists there. Obviously, they want to see the old guy,
yeah,
the one they're used to. They don't want to see the new guy. So having him there just to check hygiene with me and make those introductions and finish up a couple of things was perfect over the course of a month.
Awesome. So now let's move on to your vision. So what do you want to change now that you are maybe more comfortable, you know, confident, you know, patients are coming through the door and, you know, you've seen that over and over again. So you're getting more comfortable with that. What kind of things do you want to change now to make it your own practice?
Right. Well, let me start by saying we have digital x-rays. That was, a huge thing. Let me touch on a couple of minor things before we go big vision. Another interesting tidbit, they still have the cuspidors, I think they're called, in this practice, or as I call them, the spittoons, you know, where you swish and spit into the little sink next to the chair.
Oh, gotcha. No it's, way.
Yeah. Yep. Oh, yeah. The practice came with those. So my vision would be to get rid of those things and to bring us up to date. No, it's not that bad, but I can't stand those. So, you know, what's going to happen nicely here is I actually have to move, which stinks. I had a 5-year lease when I bought the practice, and then I'll spare you all the details, but the short answer is I'm getting kicked out and I don't have the choice to buy my space or rent it any longer than 5 years. So I have to move. So, you know, things like that are just going to come naturally when we move into the new space and we forget to bring those cuspidors with us, or we install the new chairs rather, right? So I guess my point here is that creating my vision, my ideal practice, is going to coincide nicely with as we ideally build a new office or renovate an existing space or something. So part of that is going to be technology, right? As we outfit a new space rather than trying to retrofit an old space. But part of that, part of our vision for what we want to be, you know, I just renamed my practice. I just rebranded the practice. The practice was named after the old dentist. And when I took over, I named it after myself, which I think is a great move, to be honest. If anyone's taking over a practice from an old beloved doc, because it gave patients an opportunity to get to know my name, right? They see it on the wall, they see it on the logo, and to just to try to get familiar with who I am. But I realized that I would like to bring in another dentist. I never wanted to be a solo practitioner. So that's hard to do when the practice is named after you, right? So maybe if it's like just your last name, my name is Byrnes, right? So if it's Byrnes Dentistry, then maybe you have another dentist there. But when it's Dr. Drew Brynes, Family and Cosmetic Dentistry, and now we have Dr. Eric Holtz there, and, you know, if they see anyone but Dr. Brynes, they're feeling like they're getting the short end of the stick. So we've rebranded to Park Smiles Dentistry, and the goal would be to create a park-like experience for our patients, right? Our tagline is, it's a walk in the park. So trying to make everything easy.
Okay.
Trying to make it all about the patient experience. So that's kind of where my vision's heading for our office, and trying to just over-deliver on patient experience and quality of care. And I think, you know, everybody's saying that fee-for-service dentists are going to disappear like the dinosaurs, right? People have been very vocal on these Facebook groups saying that it's a way of the past, and PPO insurances are taking over and corporate's taking over, and fee-for-service isn't going to be around in 10 years or so. And I want to do everything I can to buck that trend, to be an outlier. So I think that we have to kind of set ourselves apart. How exactly? I'm not sure just yet. That's kind of what my podcast is going to be about. I don't have all the answers, but I'm hoping to ask the right questions. And I know that there are other fee-for-service dentists out there, or at least other dentists who maybe are interested in more of a cash-based practice that would like to figure out the same thing. You know, how can we make ourselves worth going out of network for? That's kind of the main question that I'm trying to answer with the podcast and with my career, rather. So my podcast is kind of going to be detailing my journey through all of this. I'm only, 4.5 years into my career, and so if people are saying that there won't be fee-for-service dentists in 10 years, well, that's still at least 20 years before I retire. So I'm planning to practice for a long time. So I've got to figure it out. And I think it's going to be one of those things that evolves as we go, as we see what insurance companies are doing.
That's awesome. So I see now, you know, and I think that's, you know, a heightened importance. I think there's definitely importance on the patient experience and, you know, your mm-hmm. ability to relate with people and whatnot. But I think the reason why I wanted to do a little segment on fee-for-service practices is A, you know, people are looking at them because older doctors have more fee-for-service practices. And then mm-hmm. B, you know, I think all things related to transitions, it's just, I think, more heightened, you know, like the, you know, these things are still important when you're buying an insurance practice, but practice that takes insurance, but at the same time, it's maybe less important. So I think it's a good case study to look at transitions and how to look at things. So that's the whole reason we did it this way. But mm-hmm. I think in your case, you know, you're definitely going against the, you know, against the grain here a little bit. And, but there's a lot of benefits to that, and I'm sure you're realizing them. But at the same mm-hmm. time, I wanted to talk to you about one more thing before we wrap up. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I know you listened to our podcast, but we did. So I'm naturally going to ask you, the lease is, you know, having 5 years on a lease, buying a practice, that would be against what we would recommend. And so I'm mm-hmm. curious to see, as a new owner, you know, going through the process of having to move relatively young in your career owning the practice, how is that? Is that stressful, or how does that whole situation been?
Incredibly stressful. to complicate matters further, I kind of set my sights on the idea that I wanted to own wherever I moved to next.
Okay.
but real estate is really expensive around me. So that's been challenging. And, you know, I want to own it because I really don't want to get kicked out again. And yeah, I want to be able to know that this is my spot and no one's kicking me out and I can build my reputation here. Now, I'll be honest with you. What I'm planning on doing might not be the wisest financially from a numbers point of view, because right now I'm under contract to buy a property that's pretty pricey. But I think with what my plans are with expanding the practice with my associate now, I think if everything is according to plan, it's going to work out great. And we'll have a new space that's beautiful, that really lends itself to our brand and the style of practice that we're trying to create. But yeah, it's difficult. It would be wiser for me, I think, on one hand, to maybe find a space to lease and to work there for maybe 5 to 10 years and then buy, especially because everything in the market's really high right now in real estate. But I don't want to have to build, you know, a lot of reputation is tied to a location, in my opinion.
Oh yeah. Big time.
Yeah. So I don't want to waste time in that regard. I'd rather do it once and do it right. And, you know, we'll see. Hopefully it pays off for me.
I appreciate you letting me, pick apart that situation a little bit, you know, because it's just funny that on the podcast we talk about so many things. So I guess whenever somebody comes on, naturally gravitate towards the things that we've already said. But either way, I appreciate you coming on. We'll have to bring you back on sometime, maybe after you've moved or sometime to talk about what that experience has been like. But I really appreciate you coming on, Drew. And I think you were a good kickoff to our 3 episodes on fee-for-service practices. So thank you for coming on again. And anyone, check out Fee-for-Service Dentistry Podcast. And you also have a Facebook group, the
Fee-for-Service Dentistry.
There you go. Fee-for-Service Dentistry Facebook group. And we'll put links in the description for both of those.
Perfect. Thank you so much. And if anyone out there is looking at a fee-for-service practice or is maybe even thinking of doing or dropping some insurance plans or doing a startup fee-for-service, you know, obviously you got to do a lot of research to make sure it's not an insanely crazy move. But I've loved my experience. I'd say go for it if you can.
Awesome. Thanks, Drew.
Hey, you got it, George. Take care.
Welcome back, you guys. That was an awesome interview with Drew. Drew is one of our success cases that has done that really well, the fee-for-service transition. So what was most impressive to you about how he handled everything?
Well, I think the situation that he was in terms of buying a fee-for-service practice in a metro area, that's unique to the series in terms of the successful dentist. You know, he's the only successful one that we've had to have done that. And sure. Then I think, you know, his ability to grow the practice over time was impressive to me also. I felt like, you know, normally you're really focused on just keeping it the same. But he really had very consistent, healthy growth, which I think is awesome. So, very well done. And, you know, that's why he's out there trying to help people, educating them about how to do fee-for-service practices.
Yeah. One of the things that I really liked how he emphasized was his, in contrast to last week with Sandy Pardue, his willingness to come in and say, let's not change anything. Let's make it feel like the old dentist not is still here, but at least be very cognizant of that, the feel of the practice, the staff, the way that they're doing things for a while to gain those patients' trust and get to know them and transfer that relationship. I thought that was huge. And he delineated kind of what he did for that pretty well.
Yeah. And I think especially comparing his mannerisms to the seller, you know, in terms of, you know, while still being genuine, but really trying to emphasize the things that he's similar to the seller in, I think was very effective for what he was doing.
The other thing I would say is that, you know, I think in general, this is totally a stereotype, but I'm going for it, is that it seems like you kind of have to have a halfway decent personality in taking over a fee for service. Like, everyone knows their limitations and their strengths. And some people are like, yes, I can talk with people for hours and it comes naturally to me. And I'm just someone who can be positive no matter what. And other people are like, you know what? I need my space. I like doing dentistry, but I'm not going to like sell people on dentistry. I don't feel comfortable. You kind of got to know yourself. And this is especially important comparing yourself to the seller. If you're coming in and replacing someone who, whether it's personality wise, even things like ethnicity or, you know, regional area, if you can't fill a niche that's currently being filled by someone in a fee for service, and then you come in and you're completely different than the previous owner, you got to be able to transfer that trust. And so even if you're against all odds, you can still do it, but you have to be very conscious of that fact.
Yeah. And I think Drew is kind of the perfect guy for that. And I did want to mention one thing I talked about in the episode and I gave him a hard time about it. He had an issue with his lease, and I want to talk about it in the outro because I think it's important. He bought a practice, and his lease term, you know, he bought it 3 years ago, and he's now kind of scrambling, not scrambling yet, but, you know, he is looking for a place to move his practice because his lease is going to be expiring. And that's something that we talk about on the podcast. We talked about it with Rob. We also talked about with Rich Andrus in terms of finding a practice where you're buying and you have sufficient time on the lease, at least to pay off the practice note, if not more. And having some options there, And so I think that he talked about it being stressful, and I think that's a great situation to try to avoid as a buyer going into an acquisition. And, you know, if you want to move at, you know, I think it'd be better if that was your preference as opposed to, you know, maybe out of a necessity. So that's sure. something I wanted to add. And, you know, Drew is a great sport about it, but ultimately, you know, that's something that you'd like to avoid.
No, it's nice to not have to get kicked out of your new dental home that you've just now gotten used to and everyone knows where you are. And then it's like, oh crap, we got to move. So definitely a big point to take away there.
Yep. And next week we'll hear from Peter Bowman, and Peter bought a fee for service practice also. It's also one of our stories of one that went well, but he's not in the metro area, and I think it'll be a great comparison.
Awesome. Okay. We'll see you next week on the Shared Practices podcast. Thanks, George. We'll talk to you later.